Hello, the topic we are discussing today is personality development by Freud and Erikson. The objectives of this module are, at the end of this chapter, the student should be able to know the different components of personality according to Freud, explain the Freudian psychosexual stages of development, explain stages of psychosocial development according to Erikson. Sigmund Freud was a neurologist in Vienna. He often treated people who were troubled by nervous disorders. He developed an innovative procedure called psychoanalysis for the treatment of mental disorders. Freud's psychodynamic theory emphasizes that the experiences of early childhood shape the development of adult personality. Freud's theory suggests that unconscious forces act to determine personality and behavior. To Freud, the unconscious is a part of the personality about which the person is unaware. It contains infantile wishes, desires, demands, and needs that are hidden from conscious awareness because of their disturbing nature. Freud suggested that the unconscious is responsible for a good part of our everyday behavior. According to Freud, everyone's personality has three aspects: the id, ego, and superego. Id is the inborn part of personality that is present at birth. It represents primitive drives related to hunger, sex, aggression, and irrational impulses. The id operates according to the pleasure principle, in which the goal is to maximize satisfaction and reduce tension. It seeks immediate gratification of primitive pleasure-seeking impulses and has no sense of time, place, and reality. It is the main reservoir of life and death instinct. The instinct originates in conscious mind, goes to the unconscious when it is not fulfilled, and forms a mental image or hallucination of the object to reduce tension. The ego strives to balance the desires of the id and the realities of the objective world. The ego is the part of the personality that is rational and reasonable. The ego operates on reality principle, in which instinctual energy is restrained in order to maintain the safety of the individual and help the person to conform to the norms of the society. The ego directs behavior towards maximal satisfaction of the individual's urges, consistent with the knowledge of the social and physical reality. In a sense, the ego is the executive of personality. It makes decisions, controls actions, and allows thinking and problem solving of a higher order that the id is incapable of. Thirdly, the superego, the final personality structure to develop, represents social right and wrong as taught and modeled by a person's parents, teachers, and other significant individuals. The superego internalizes representation of the values and morals of society as taught by parents. It is composed of conscience, which incorporates all the things that the child is punished for or reprimanded. The ego ideal, which includes those actions the child is rewarded for doing. The conscience prevents us from behaving in a morally improper way by making us feel guilty if we do wrong. And the ego ideal represents the perfect person that we wish we were and motivates us to do what is morally right. The main functions of superego are to inhibit the impulses of the id, particularly those that the society prohibits, for example, sexual behavior and aggression. Secondly, it persuades the ego to substitute moralistic goals for the realistic ones. And it also strives for perfection. The superego and id share an important feature. Both are unrealistic, that is, they do not consider practical realities imposed by the society. The superego, if left to operate without restraint, would create perfectionists, that is, individuals who are unable to make compromises that life requires. Similarly, unrestrained id would create a primitive, pleasure-seeking, thoughtless individual seeking to fulfill every desire without delay. As a result, the ego must compromise between the demands of the superego and demands of the id. So the id seeks pleasure, the ego tests reality, and superego strives for perfection. When the three components are at odds, the ego postpones gratification of urges that the id wants. The superego battles with both the id and the ego because behavior often falls short of the moral code it represents. In a normal person, the three work as a team, producing integrated behavior. To Freud, personality development takes place in five discrete stages. Firstly, the oral stage, anal stage, phallic stage, latency stage, and finally, genital stage. In the first stage of development, called the oral stage, the baby's mouth is the focal point of pleasure. During the first 12 to 18 months of life, children suck and bite anything that fits into their mouth and strive for oral satisfaction. To Freud, this behavior suggested that the mouth is the primary site of a kind of sexual pleasure. Infants who are either overly indulged or frustrated in their search for oral gratification become fixated at this stage. Fixation refers to conflicts or concerns that persist beyond the developmental period in which they first occur. Such conflicts can be due to one's needs being either ignored or overly indulged during the earlier period. For example, fixation might occur if an infant's oral needs were constantly and immediately satisfied at first signs of hunger. Fixation at this stage might produce an adult who is unusually interested in oral activities such as eating, talking, and smoking. In the second to third year, the child is in the anal stage and gets pleasure by the process of retention and expulsion of feces and urine. If toilet training is particularly demanding, it may result in fixation. Adults who are fixated in the anal stage might show unusual rigidity, orderliness and punctuality, or extreme disorderliness or sloppiness. In the third stage, called the phallic stage, from 3 years to 6 years, the children's sexual curiosity is aroused. Here, the child distinguishes between the pleasure derived from anal region and from the genitals and notices the difference between male and female sex organs. Freud saw this stage as critical for the formation of gender identity. According to Freud, sexual drives are temporarily submerged during the fourth stage of latency period, which begins from 6 years to the age of puberty. During this period, children prefer relationships with the same gender than with relationships of other gender. In the last stage, the genital period, which begins from puberty onwards, sexual desires re-emerge and are directed towards peers. By the end of the genital stage, the adolescent has a stable personality and the ego and the superego develop to maintain a balance between id, ego and superego. If these psychosexual stages are completed successfully, the result is a healthy personality. If certain issues are not resolved at the appropriate stage, then fixation occurs. In conclusion, according to Freud, personality is mostly established by the age of 5. Early experiences play a large role in personality development and continue to influence behavior later in life. The theory is focused almost entirely on male development, with little mention of female psychosexual development. His theories are difficult to test scientifically. Few concepts are impossible to measure and therefore cannot be tested. The research that has been conducted tends to discredit Freud's theory. Future predictions that could be made on the basis of theory are too vague. How can we know that a current behavior was caused specifically because of a childhood experience? The length of time between the cause and effect is too long to assume that there is a relationship between the two variables. Freud's theory is based upon case studies and not empirical research. Also, Freud based his theory on the recollections of his adult patients, not on actual observation and study of children. Erikson provided an alternative psychodynamic perspective in his theory of psychosocial development. His theory of psychosocial development emphasizes our social interaction with other people. Society and culture both challenge and shape us. Psychosocial development encompasses changes in our interactions and understanding of one another, as well as in our knowledge and understanding of oneself as members of society. Erikson maintained that children develop in a predetermined order. Erikson's theory of psychosocial development has 8 distinct stages, each with 2 possible outcomes. According to the theory, successful completion of each stage results in a healthy personality, whereas failure leads to a more unhealthy personality and sense of self. These stages, however, can be resolved successfully at a later time. Erikson's theory of psychosocial development has 8 distinct stages. Trust versus mistrust spans from birth to 1 year. Autonomy versus shame and doubt from 2 to 3 years. Initiative versus guilt, 3 to 6 years. Industry versus inferiority, 6 years to puberty. Identity versus role confusion occurs in adolescence. Intimacy versus isolation occurs during young adulthood. Generativity versus stagnation occurs during middle adulthood. And ego integrity versus despair occurs in senior citizens. In the first stage of trust versus mistrust, children begin to learn to trust to others based upon the consistency of their caregivers. If trust develops successfully, the child gains confidence and security in the world around him and is able to feel secure even when threatened. Unsuccessful completion of this stage can result in an inability to trust and therefore a sense of fear about the inconsistent world. It may result in anxiety, heightened insecurities, and feeling of mistrust in the world around them. Studies say that children whose parents have mutual problems because of which they are not able to devote sufficient time to their child have increased tendencies to develop such negative attitudes of mistrust. In the second stage of autonomy versus shame and doubt, children begin to assert themselves and their independence and start doing things on their own. If children get support in their increased independence, they become more confident and secure. On the other hand, if children are controlled or not given the opportunity to assert themselves, they begin to feel inadequate in their ability to survive. They become dependent upon others, lack self-esteem, and feel a sense of shame or doubt in their own abilities. It is seen that children whose parents exercise more than requisite control over them, in the long run, develop into individuals without any opinion, choice, and decision-making ability. They are not even able to make a call on the profession that they want to choose. In the third stage of initiative versus guilt, children begin to plan and initiate activities with others. Given this opportunity, children develop a sense of initiative, feel secure in their ability to lead others and make decisions. Failure to do the above creates a sense of guilt among children. They may feel like a nuisance to others and will therefore remain followers, lacking in self-initiative. Coming to the stage of industry versus inferiority, children begin to develop a sense of satisfaction in their accomplishments. If children are encouraged, reinforced for their work, they begin to feel industrious and feel confident in their ability to achieve goals. If this initiative is not encouraged and is restricted by parents or teachers, the child begins to feel inferior, doubting his own abilities and therefore may not reach his potential. coming to the stage of identity versus role confusion. Now, up until this fifth stage, development depends on what is done to the person. At this point, development now depends primarily upon what a person does. People become more independent, and during this stage, they explore possibilities and begin to form their own identity based upon the outcome of their explorations. This sense of who they are can be hindered, which results in a sense of confusion about themselves and their role in the world. Coming to the stage of intimacy versus isolation, people begin to share themselves more intimately with others. They explore relationships leading towards long-term commitments with someone other than a family member. Successful completion can lead to comfortable relationships and a sense of commitment, safety, and care within a relationship. Avoiding intimacy, fearing commitment and relationships can lead to isolation, loneliness, and sometimes depression. A prime example of this is the ever-increasing trend in the number of psychological patients resulting from unsuccessful commitments to relationships. Due to the stressful life in the professional sphere, people are not able to devote time to their relationship, which ultimately ends up in a disaster leading to distress and depression. In the stage of generativity versus stagnation, career and work are the most important things at this stage, along with family responsibilities. Middle adulthood is also the time when people take on greater responsibilities and control. If the individuals accomplish themselves in their careers and fulfill their family responsibilities, they have a sense of accomplishment without which they would feel stagnant and unproductive. Coming to the stage of ego integrity versus despair, people tend to slow down in their productivity and explore life as a retired person. It is during this time that they contemplate upon their accomplishments and are able to develop integrity if they see themselves as leading a successful life. If they see their lives as unproductive, feel guilty about their past, or feel that they did not accomplish their life goals, they become dissatisfied with life and develop despair. This often leads to depression and hopelessness. No one moves through the eight stages of life without failing at any one stage. At each stage, people experience both positive and negative aspects. The challenge is to get the positive aspects to outnumber the negative aspects. In conclusion, we can say, according to Erikson's theory, psychosocial development continues throughout the lifespan. Although his theory has been criticized on several grounds, such as the imprecision of the concepts he employs and his greater emphasis on male development than female development, the theory remains influential and is one of the few theories that encompass the entire lifespan.